Hello everyone, I am Dr. Kiran Mohi. Today's topic is diuretics and antidiuretics. These drugs act on kidney. The main function of the kidney is excretion of waste products like urea, uric acid and creatinine. And it maintains homeostasis of extracellular fluid and electrolytes. Diuretic drugs increase the urinary output of electrolytes and water from the kidney by interfering with one or more reabsorptive processes occurring at different segments of nephron. What is a diuretic? Diuretic is a drug which promotes the excretion of water and sodium from the body. Classification of diuretics. These diuretics are classified as first group of drugs. These are loop diuretics. They act on loop of Henle. Example for the loop diuretics are furosemide, torsemide, bumetanide. Second group of drugs, thiazide diuretics. They act on distal convoluted tubule of nephron. Example for the these thiazide diuretics are polythiazide, hydrochlorothiazide, chlorothiazide. Next group of drugs, thiazide-like diuretics. These are chemically related to the thiazides. Example for these are indapamide, chlorothalidone, metalazone. Next group of drugs are potassium sparing diuretics. Example for these are amiloride, triamterene, furanolactone. Next group is carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. An example for these group of drugs, acetazolamide, metazolamide, dorzolamide. The last group, these drugs acting indirectly by modifying the contents of urinary filtrate. These are osmotic diuretics. Example for osmotic diuretics are mannitol and glycerol. This is a nephron. Here it is depicting different parts of nephron and different groups of diuretics acts on which parts of nephron. As we see, carbonic anhydrase enzyme inhibitors, they act on proximal convoluted tubule. Here, loop diuretics, they act on thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. Thiazides, they act on DCT. Potassium sparing diuretics, they act on collecting ducts. Next, we'll go to the loop diuretics. These loop diuretics, these are called high ceiling diuretics because they promote 20 to 30% of excretion of sodium from the body. Mechanism of action. These act on thick ascending loop of Henle by inhibiting the sodium potassium 2-chloride transporter pump. This is a main mechanism. Second one is these loop diuretics induce renal prostaglandin synthesis. By inhibiting the sodium potassium 2-chloride pump, urinary excretion of sodium and chloride are increased. The increased sodium concentration in the urinary filtrate in distal convoluted tubule promotes the loss of H+ and potassium. These loop diuretics also causes loss of calcium and magnesium. And coming to the next mechanism, which induce renal prostaglandin synthesis. These prostaglandins which increase the venous capacitance. So in left ventricular failure, it will provide the it will decrease the preload. So it is useful in pulmonary edema and left ventricular failure. Therapeutic uses. The most important indication for use of loop diuretics are edematous conditions like congestive heart failure, cirrhosis of liver, nephrotic syndrome. These are used in hypertensive emergencies. In hypertension, the first line of drugs are thiazide diuretics. These loop diuretics are used in hypertensive emergencies. In loop diuretics, they are used in bromide and iodide poisoning because these bromide and iodides are absorbed from the same pump where these loop diuretics inhibit. These are used in non-diuretic use of loop diuretics. Excretion. These loop diuretics can be used to treat mild to moderate hypercalcemia because they increase calcium excretion. Adverse effects of the loop diuretics. Loop diuretics can cause hyperuricemia and precipitate the attack of gout. And they cause electrolyte imbalance. Electrolyte changes, like they will cause hyponatremia, decreased sodium, hypokalemia, decreased potassium, hypocalcemia, decreased calcium in the serum, hypomagnesemia, decreased magnesium. The other adverse effects includes these loop diuretics cause hyperglycemia, hypersensitivity reactions. The next group of drugs are thiazide diuretics. The thiazide diuretics are, these are also called moderate saline diuretics. They will cause 10-12% of sodium loss from the body. Mechanism of action. They inhibit sodium chloride antiport at distal convoluted tubule. By inhibiting this pump, sodium and chloride are excreted in the urinary filtrate, in turns which eliminates the H plus and potassium also. The therapeutic uses of the thiazide diuretics, these are as earlierly we said, these are the first line drugs which are used in hypertension, and second one, edema. These drugs are used in edema, like edema caused by nephrotic syndrome, pulmonary edema, renal stones. The non-diuretic use of thiazide is they used to treat the renal stones because they decrease the calcium loss from the body. This character is used in osteoporosis also. Treat the osteoporosis because thiazide diuretics can be useful in treating idiopathic hypercalciuria because they inhibit the urinary calcium excretion. The effect is therefore beneficial for the patient suffering from renal calculi. Adverse effects. Thiazide diuretics cause hypokalemia, hypochloremic alkalosis. It will cause hyperuricemia. It will cause hypercalcemia, hyperglycemia, hyperlipidemia. These are the adverse drug reactions of thiazide diuretics. Next group of diuretics are potassium sparing diuretics. These are weak diuretics. These will cause 5-10% of sodium loss. These drugs act on collecting ducts. In the collecting duct, aldosterone in collecting the aldosterone receptors are present. When aldosterone binds to the aldosterone receptors, it facilitates the opening of sodium potassium H plus pump, which promote the sodium excretion, which promote the sodium reabsorption, H plus and potassium excretion. By inhibiting this aldosterone receptor by aldosterone antagonist, it will cause reverse elimination of excretion of sodium occurs and absorption of potassium and H plus increased. These potassium sparing diuretics are two groups: aldosterone antagonist and epithelial sodium channel blockers. Aldosterone antagonists are spironolactone, eplerenone. Epithelial sodium channel blockers are triamterin, amiloride. Epithelial sodium channel blockers. Example for epithelial sodium channel blockers are amiloride and triamterin. Therapeutic uses of these epithelial sodium channel blockers. They are given along with a loop and thiazide diuretic to counteract the potassium loss. Non-diuretic use. These are used in the cystic fibrosis. Adverse drug reactions. They will, in excessive use, they will cause hyperkalemia. Triamterin causes renal stones. Aldosterone receptor antagonists. Example for this are spironolactone and eplerenone. These drugs, spironolactone is an aldosterone receptor antagonist with a limited diuretic action. It acts on collecting duct, where it will cause only 3 to 5% of sodium chloride absorption. It has long duration of action because it undergoes enterohepatic circulation. As earlierly discussed, this aldosterone antagonist, they inhibit the sodium reabsorption, which promote the potassium reabsorption. Therapeutic uses are, they are used in edematous disorders due to primary hyperaldosteronism, that is Kahn's syndrome, or secondary hyperaldosteronism. It is used along with loop diuretics or thiazide diuretics. Non-diuretic uses in congestive heart failure, where it is used in conditions of second one, in conditions of hypokalemia. Adverse effects, hyperkalemia. Number two, it will cause it will delay the healing of peptic ulcer. Third one, it will cause GIT disturbances. It causes gynecomastia in male, menstrual irregularities in female. Next group of drugs are osmotic diuretics. These osmotic diuretics what is osmosis? Osmosis means absorption of water. To become a good osmotic diuretic, it should possess four characteristics. First one is, it is freely filtered by glomeruli. It is chemically inert. It should not be reabsorbed from the nephron. it should exert osmotic effect. Example for the osmotic diuretics are mannitol and glycerol. Therapeutic uses of osmotic diuretics. These diuretics are used in glaucoma, cerebral edema. Contraindications of these osmotic diuretics: cerebral hemorrhage, left ventricular failure, and pulmonary edema. In left ventricle failure and pulmonary edema, it will increase the preload. So these osmotic diuretics are contraindicated. The last group of drugs are carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. These are weak diuretics. It will cause 5 to 10% of sodium excretion. Normally these carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, they presented renal tubules, gastric mucosa, pancreatic cells. Mechanism of action: carbonic anhydrase enzyme which promotes the absorption of bicarbonate in the form of sodium bicarbonate. While inhibiting this enzyme, which causes loss of sodium and bicarbonate from the body, it also causes potassium loss from the body. So due to loss of bicarbonate, it will cause alkalinization of urine. Loss of potassium, it will cause hypokalemia. Therapeutic uses of carbonic anhydrase enzyme inhibitors. These are used in open angle glaucoma, alkalization of urine. These are the drug of choice in mountain sickness, epilepsy. Nowadays there are many drugs for epilepsy, so these are not that much indicated, but these are having anti-epileptic property. The adverse effects of carbonic anhydrase enzyme inhibitors: they promote the renal stone formation because they alkalinize the urine. In alkaline urine, calcium tend to precipitate, so renal stones will be formed. Because of loss of potassium, it will cause hypokalemia. Contraindications of carbonic anhydrase enzyme inhibitors: the contraindications are liver failure, hepatic coma. Nursing care for the diuretic patients who are taking diuretic drugs. Nursing care: monitor blood pressure. Second one, blood glucose level. If the patient is diabetic, maintain fluid intake and output chart. Assess the signs of alkalosis by drowsiness, restlessness of the patient. Assess hypokalemia by postural hypertension, fatigue, weakness, leg cramps. The dose of diuretics always should be in the early hours, that is in the morning, to avoid sleep disturbances. So these are the nursing instructions for the next topic is antidiuretics. Antidiuretics: vasopressin, ADH, antidiuretic hormone. It is released by posterior pituitary in response to increased plasma osmolarity or decreased BP. By promoting the water resorption from the collecting ducts of kidney, or increased vasoconstriction. The vasoconstriction action exhibited at higher doses. This vasopressin is also called as ADH, antidiuretic hormone, arginine vasopressin. Deficiency of this vasopressin results in diabetes insipidus. Diabetes means overflow, insipidus means tasteless. It is not diabetes mellitus. This diabetes insipidus is two types. First one is due to non-function of ADH receptors or dysfunction of posterior pituitary. Dysfunction of posterior pituitary is called nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, neurogenic diabetes insipidus. Non-function of ADH receptors is nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. The symptoms of diabetic insipidus is excretion of large amounts of urine, dehydration, and thirst. The patient may die due to dehydration. The central diabetes insipidus, dysfunction of ADH. In nephrogenic receptors in the collecting duct, they are not working. So drugs, it may be due to drugs or heavy metal poisoning. In nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, hormone is normal amount. This is how the ADH is regulated. When dehydration is there, it stimulates osmoreceptors, which stimulate hypothalamic neurosecretory cells to synthesize ADH. These ADH in posterior pituitary, it releases from the posterior pituitary, which will cause increased BP due to vasoconstriction, decreased urine output. It will cause water resorption, decrease sweating. And negative feedback is when overhydration is there, same these osmoreceptors sense the osmotic pressure. They inhibit the ADH secretion by hypothalamic neurosecretory cells are inhibited, which will cause the synthesis of ADH. ADH is having two receptors, V1 and V2. V1 is again divided into V1A and V1B. The V1 receptors, V1A and V1B, they mediate vasopressor action. V2 receptor, they mediate antidiuretic action. Now we discuss about ADH receptor antagonist. First one, vasopressin analogs. These vasopressin analogs, first one is vasopressin. Vasopressin is having duration of action is very less, that is 20 minutes. It is non-selective for V1 and V2. It should be given IV or ID, intravenous or intradermal. Second drug in the group is desmopressin. Its action lasts for 10 hours. It has V2 receptor specificity. The route of administration is oral or parenteral. It is 10 to 15 times potent than the vasopressin. Third group is terlipressin. It is a prodrug. It has V1 selective action and minimal V2 action. It is used in the treatment of varicose bleeding to stop the bleeding. Filariprazine. It has only V1 action. It is used in combination with anesthetic to prolong their action. Therapeutic uses of ADH and ADH receptor agonist drugs. The therapeutic use, these are used in esophageal varices to stop or arrest the bleeding. The preferred drug is terlipressin. To relieve the postoperative paralytic release, these are used in abdominal surgeries. If the patient is suffering from portal hypertension, to reduce the hemorrhage. These drugs are used in acute hemorrhagic gastritis. V2 mediated actions. First one, these are used in diabetes insipidus, only in neurogenic causes. Drug of choice here is desmopressin. It is also used in nocturnal enuresis with the restricted fluid intake at bedtime to relieve the post-lumbar puncture headache. The adverse effects, V1 receptor mediated, are facial pallor, nausea, abdominal cramps. These drugs are contraindicated in ischemic heart disease, hypertension. Adverse effects of V2 receptor mediated actions, fluid retention, hyponatremia. ADH receptor antagonist. These are used in SIADH. Here, antidiuretic hormone is inappropriate. That means it is in higher level. Drugs in the group are ponivaptan. Ponivaptan, its duration of action is 5 hours. It is used in congestive heart failure with the water retention. It is administered in its route is intravenously. It is non-selective of it inhibit it antagonizes V1 V2 both. Tolvaptan, it's a newer drug. It can be given oral. It has more V2 selective action. Rixivaptan, cetavaptan, mosuvaptan, these are the newer drugs. They still need approval. Indications for the ADH receptor antagonist. These are indicated in SIADH, cirrhosis ascites. Side effects. Side effects of the ADH receptor antagonist. These are postural hypertension, hypokalemia, polydipsia, nausea. The gist is, diuretics, they are mainly used in edematous conditions. Some diuretics, that is thiazide diuretics, they are first line drugs in hypertension. Osmotic diuretics, they are mainly used in cerebral edema. Carbonic anhydrase enzyme inhibitors, they are drug of choice for the mountain sickness. Antidiuretic hormones. These antidiuretic hormone, here we have discussed two group of drugs: ADH receptor agonist action agonist and ADH receptor antagonist. ADH receptor agonist we used in conditions like decreased ADH secretion in neurogenic diabetes insipidus. ADH receptor antagonists we used in increased levels of ADH, that is in SIADH. Thank you.